this show is about discussing vinyl, primarily gaming vinyl. And that is why this week, I'm privileged to have a wonderful special guest here for episode 4, right on time, actually, as soon as the raid's here, proper timing. Bring on our special guest, JroctheGod.
Yo, what's going on, man?
What's going on?
Glad we finally linked up to get this done, man.
And like I said, I don't think it's just a one-time thing. This feels like it's going to happen again.
I'd be honored. I'd be honored. What's going on, chat?
Yo, chat, pop off. You know who it is. If you didn't know, now you know. You didn't recognize him, now you recognize him.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, y'all. I'm just waking up. Give me a second to get this coffee in me.
Gotta get that coffee in him.
But yeah, it's good to be here. And you was talking about black screen earlier, and that's where I get a lot of my records from as well. In particular, like the ones that are on the wall. You can't see them very well, can you?
Nope.
You can see a couple of them maybe. But there's like three I think that might be in the camera view.
Yeah.
It should be Majora's Mask, Resident Evil 2, and Code Veronica.
Okay.
Those three, I got those from Black. I believe I got those from Black Screen Records. But yeah, those are.
See, you can speak to it then. You understand.
Yeah.
You get it.
Yes.
Black Screen Records
Black
is
Screen
it.
That work?
Yeah. I bet.
No. Sorry. I got Resident Evil 2 from Laced Records.
Oh, okay. Laced Records. Good choice. Good choice. By the way, Pleasantly Twisted loves your hat.
Thank you.
I like that. Just a simple thank you. So if you would take an opportunity, I feel like everyone who should know you are knows who you are, but not people know who you are. So I need you to go ahead and pop off a little bit. Let me know what it is you do here in the gaming space on Twitch, your achievements, accomplishments, what you've been doing, what you're doing next, all that good stuff, and you know, all that.
All right, I guess we run down the list, right? Hi, I'm JroctheGod. Most people just call me J-Rock. Some people call me John. I've been a Twitch streamer since, 2017? I've been a Twitch partner. I've been full-time since 2017. I've been a partner since 2018. I've been an ambassador since the last year. I'm known as the guy who plays games with his toes. I've been in articles from Wired to Kotaku. I love vinyl, and as far as games goes, I've beaten everything from the entire Resident Evil series to the Dark Souls series, Metal Gear Solid series, just a plethora of things. Whatever I feel like I'm comfortable with putting my toes on a controller for, I've done and probably succeeded.
So, this is that brick. All right, cool. So, playing stuff with your toes.
Mm-hmm.
Love that. Since this is a music-based show, I gotta ask, have you ever been in the realm of like a Guitar Hero or a Rock Band with the toes?
Oh, funny story about that. I did buy one for Christmas 2018, I believe.
Okay.
And it was gonna be a thing, and then I lost the dongle. I don't know how I lost the dongle, but I lost the dongle. And I was just like, you know, I didn't want to make a big scene of it because I didn't want to make it seem like I was running away from it because I wasn't. But then I just never found another controller for a reasonable price or replacement part. So it just never went back to it.
But you weren't running away from that at all.
I wasn't. If I could find another dongle, we'll try it again.
All right.
If somebody wants to send me a guitar, we'll do it.
All right. I believe in you. People love your music, by the way. So, John, right now, what does video game vinyl mean to you? Like, why vinyl?
There's a nostalgic feeling to it. I'm the type of person who loves to close his eyes and visualize, whether it's visualizing in the moment or like remembering the past. So specifically for the three on the wall behind me, those three games were a huge part of my childhood. So hearing the sounds of those, specifically Resident Evil 2, I can go back to when we first played it and think about sitting on the couch next to my pops and my younger brother and how we would like have to strategize through the games. And we had like a very, very limited memory card back then. We had a memory card, so I guess we were fortunate in that regard, because I hear stories about people who didn't have one. But, you know, we didn't really like have a lot of space to make it. So we would have the one save that we have for RE2. We would just be like, all right, do we want to save over it now? Is this a good idea? Are we going to screw ourselves? We're going to have to restart the entire thing. So like every song kind of has like a specific memory to a conversation for me, like a good time, which is why I like a lot of the old school retro vinyl music.
It brings you back to a certain time period, and that's one thing everyone's agreed with, is that it's not just I like the music that I hear, which is the case a lot of times, but every now and then, I think sometimes when I want to go back to a moment, I do play that music, something familiar. So, like for me, like for fighting game music, as much as I love Street Fighter, my Street Fighter 2 music is attached to my memories playing them with my brother and sister growing up. And when I hear Honda's theme, I think of my sister. And when I happen to hear, you know, Ken's theme, I think of my brother, because that's who they picked. And they wouldn't want to go to their stage if they could. It was an option to do so. A lot of times it wasn't. But hearing that music, it takes me back to those moments, and I can sit there and I feel like I'm there again.
For sure, for sure. Like, I don't think I have like the same memories of fighting games as you, because mostly mine was me getting my behind whooped.
Yeah.
So whenever I hear like a specific theme, I think of a specific cousin, but I think of that cousin, you know, kind of giving me the business. So
you spot them at that family reunion, you start hearing the music in your head. Like,
yeah,
hey, yo, cuz!
It's the reason I don't own a Tekken vinyl, I'll say that.
Hear it in your head. England! Like, oh, no.
Oh, no.
They're here. Da-da-da-da-da. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's cool. And since you attach music and video game music to certain memories, what is it, I guess, either quality or mechanically, why vinyl? Why not Spotify? Why not YouTube?
It's a different feeling, like a different sound. You can hear everything coming through it with the vinyl as opposed to with like headphones. I don't really have like super expensive headphones, you can tell, but like the sound quality from the vinyl and kind of like the hissing noise as well too.
Yeah.
My mother played a lot of vinyls when I was younger. Actually, hold on one second, because she gave me a gift before I left.
Oh, okay.
Give me a second. I don't know where it is in this bin, but I know it's in this bin.
You do you.
But before I moved out and she knew I was into collecting vinyl, she was just like, hey, I got a present for you.
Okay.
And she gave me her copy, like the
old
copy of Michael Jackson Bad. So, and this was a record that she used to play a lot when I was a kid. She gave me this and the Orange Juice Jones. I don't know if y'all know who Orange Juice Jones is, but like she had like a lot of like older records, and it was just like, you know, these are the memories that I grew up on, that the sound of vinyls in the living room. So this is... That's why it brings out the overall feeling of the nostalgia, like all of it. Just makes me feel like a kid again.
That is so beautiful to look at. Mm-hmm. And I think what people tend to underestimate.
I didn't notice it too, like you can see the tape on it. This is like really, really old.
Bro, look. Before the rock and the turtleneck and the gold chain and the fanny pack and jeans, technically, even by a few months before Eddie Murphy and Raw, before Eddie Murphy and Delirious, actually after Delirious, there was Michael Jackson in Bad with that album cover. I mean, I like all his album covers. I mean, we all like Thriller, obviously. There's Dangerous has a really nice album cover. But something about Bad, the way he stands, the curls, the jacket, like.
The leather jacket, yep.
Yeah. That needs to be out there somewhere. Appreciated by everybody else. So
yeah.
I feel the same way with you. Apparently someone else has that vinyl right there too. Kettle Pot Gaming, you got that vinyl? It's a good vinyl to own.
Mm-hmm, it is.
So since we're discussing vinyl right now, let's go ahead and pop off a bit. What is your newest vinyl?
My newest vinyl?
Yeah.
This is one I got in August. I haven't bought a few in a couple months, but it was Silent Hill 3. I'm grabbing it for you right now.
All right.
I got it from Mondo. Mondo's another place that I get a lot of my vinyls from, because Mondo Shop also does video game records.
Okay.
So, and Mondo usually does special custom prints. So you can get, there's might be stores that sells like the same prints. Like you might be able to get like, most places have the black prints, and some places might have like a specific color print, but yep. Mondo usually has like their own custom print. So for Silent Hill 3,
oh my nice god,
purple, it's beautiful.
That is beautiful. Oh my
beautiful
god, bro. And y'all saw during the countdown when I was spinning Death's Door, classic black vinyls, you know, is good to look at. But in certain environments, when you see that vinyl spinning, it transports you somewhere else. A different color vinyl just going around in circles, I'm telling you, it just hits a bit differently than everything else. Mm-hmm. That's a good choice. And Mondo does do special colors. And Honest Lime, that's how you end up playing yourself, because you find out a vinyl's being released by four places on the same day. Like, that was me with Sable and that OST done by Japanese mm-hmm. Breakfast. And that day, I had all four tabs open, and I knew the one I wanted, but I was afraid of the domino effect. Like, I had to go to buy it, sold out. And I go, okay, I'll go to the second best one. Buy it, mm-hmm. sold out. Next thing you know, you got three sites left, and you're like, oh, no, I'm not going to get any of them.
You remember when the Silk Sonic vinyl released, and they did the same thing?
Where yes!
It was like, all right, you got to go to Target to either get, like, I think it was Target that had, like, the color print, and then it was their website that had the bonus track, and then it was, I think, Walmart that had, like, the special, like, velvet sleeve. I'm like, come on, man.
Yep.
Why y'all got to do this?
And the thing is, you know, more than anything, I just want to get this because it's going to get got by everybody else. Mm-hmm. So I want mine, but man, when they all look good, it's like, I can't buy all these.
Yeah, man.
I mean, I could, but it's not a good look.
You know what they're doing.
They do. And they do it so well. What is, on that newest vinyl you have right there, and that Silent Hill schmix you got right there, what is your favorite track off of there?
Breeze and Monochrome Night. The drums of it, like
Breeze
when it sets in, it's like one of those songs where it's just like, it starts off like with that nice horror feel, and then when the drums come in, it's just like, that's just something that helps me zone into a focus. Like, it's on one of my focus playlists as well too, where I'm just like working on stuff. Like I love that song.
You know what I think we're gonna do is, as a family, we're gonna listen to a brief sample if we can. That way you can all be on the same page. All right, chat, can y'all hear that?
It takes a little while to kick in for this song, too.
Now, if you're watching on VOD, you're probably not going to hear this. This is a heads up to all y'all. Just letting y'all know.
That's why we say the name, so you can look it up.
Yeah. So you can join in with us right now. You can go ahead, pop it up on YouTube if you got it. Here's the link right there so you can listen with us in case you have any muting. Mm-hmm. Bro, I got to ask you right now. This has been going on for 40 seconds.
One minute.
Okay, I'm glad you knew.
1 minute, exactly when it kicks in.
I feel like it's like when you do a freestyle rap and they go, yeah, ready for this? Ooh, never mind. Oh, let me shut up.
Yeah.
Let me shut up. Oh my God. This is so good.
And a lot of Silent Hill 3's music has like that, you know, that ambient noise that you hear in the back that I don't know how to describe it, but it's like the windy sounding noise. Like that completes, like, and to my opinion, a lot of their music for me, like, it's just so freaking good.
So elaborate, when does this take place in the game? When do you hear this?
Damn, I don't remember off the top of my head.
The reason why I asked is because, as people know, I'm what you might call a coward gamer. I'm not a coward in real life. I'm not a coward with films and not a coward with confrontation. But like in games, something just happens in me that I can't do it. So I've played, like, here's the thing. Resident Evil 1, 2, and 3, I've beaten. I won't do it again. Silent Hill, I always rent it from the game store just because I was a curious kid. Or I worked at Babbage's and I could take it home and try it out. But it was never like, I'm going to buy this and I'm definitely going to make it to the end of the game. No Silent Hill has gotten that from me. So when I hear this music, it's like, damn, you're telling me if I could just suffer at a few more levels, I could have hurt this? Because I would have made that a goal.
They usually happen during like cutscenes and stuff like that, so the music and things like that cut in. But I've played Silent Hills 1, 2, and 3. I played 3 the least. I think I've only played 3 about twice. I've heard the soundtrack numerous times from watching people such as, I'm not familiar with Nub Zombie and someone like a Ravenheart or Maxi Lobes and guys like that
yeah.
are constantly doing breakdowns of the series, and that's when I really, really developed a love for the music. I'm not gonna lie to you, I was in the same boat that you were when I first played these games. Silent Hill was one of the first survival horror series that I played kind of on my own, so I was a little scared too. So I wasn't like wrapped up in the music in it, I was just like, you know, more fighting for my life. it was more fighting for my life. So I didn't really like have that deep of an appreciation of the music until I started watching those guys. And that's when I was just like, yeah, let me go back and get these finals.
Love it. Love your comments, by the way. Chat, keep them coming. If I had a vinyl player 100%, I'd be busting out game OSTs all day. Game OSTs are deeply precious to me. And they should be to a lot of people. You know, they sound really good. Silent Hill, great pickup. I'm glad you have that as your newest vinyl. Fantastic choice. So what is a vinyl that you want and don't have yet?
For sure, one of the ones that I want is, I feel like, one that you personally teased me with a lot, which was the soundtrack to The Last Dragon.
All right.
I don't think you did it intentionally, but every time I see it, I get a little upset.
I do it on purpose.
Every time I see it, I'm just like, oh, man, you doing it again, man.
He got me. Right. I'm not going to lie. That might be on purpose. No disrespect. That might be on purpose.
No. I understand it. I love it. I love seeing it because for me, when I didn't know it was a thing, like I could get that on a vinyl until I saw you with it. And I'm just like, oh, let me go look this up. And then yep. I went to look it up and I couldn't, it was very, very hard for me to find. And then I think it was you who put me on to Discogs.
Yeah.
At the time. And I was just like, oh, I can get it from Discogs. And then I'm going to go back to it in probably like a week.
You know,
see if I can get it.
What's interesting to me is that every now and then I have to ask the question on the vinyl show, okay, why that vinyl? But I don't, like, I already know the answer. It's The Last Dragon.
Yes.
Like, it's classic, what is that, 1980s?
1980s.
Yeah, it's classic 1980s music. Like, here's the thing with the 80s. 80s might have been cheesy as hell, but even as a kid who grew up later on in the 90s and aughts, 90s and 2000s music is usually just the newest pop release music. Something about 80s music always just kind of hit, especially if it was either people fighting for their lives, or wearing tacky tuxes and jackets, and they're going through something. They're walking through the beach, the sunset, the cars flipped. That music just hits differently.
Mm-hmm. So I got a funny story about the cast of The Last Dragon.
Okay.
Back when I was living in New York City, we used to work for transit, right? We used to do railroad reconstruction. So it was one time we was doing overtime up in the, it was like the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And we finished at about like, I want to say noon, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And it was me and my boy, and he's walking around and we're going to get food, right? So I think we went into a Whole Foods and we're kind of dirty, but it don't matter. We just got out of work.
Fair.
But he has on a Kiss My Converse shirt. And you run into Leroy Green.
No way.
Wearing the Kiss My Converse shirt. And he didn't recognize him at first. So he looks at the shirt and he's smiling. And he's just like, you know, what's he looking at? And I'm like, yo, that's Leroy. That's
Bruce. What's his name? Timac? Something like that? Timac, I think is his real name.
I think it's something like that. Yeah, yeah.
He ran into him with the Kiss My Converse shirt.
With the Kiss My Converse shirt on. It was something, man. He was just like, you know, appreciative that people like still showing love to the movie from all these years now.
Oh, man. I'm so like, when did that happen? Like, how recently was that?
This was summer of 2019.
Oh, so actually during the social media era when TikTok and Vine and those things were existent.
Yep.
And there was no moment like, hey, what's up right now? I'm here with the bummy right here. You know what it is, baby? None of that?
Nah, because we were actually supposed to be on the clock. So.
Oh. Snitching yourself.
So we were just like, yo, we didn't want to like snitch on ourselves. He got a picture. I don't think I took a picture, but he has a picture. I could probably ask him for it. Still got his number. But yeah.
Oh, your friend
like,
did.
Yo, my friend got a picture.
I thought you meant Bruce Leroy. Like, he got a picture. Like, hey, like, can I get a photo with you guys?
No. My friend went got a picture with him. I was like, you know, that's. Yeah, you got the shirt on. That's your moment right there. I'm gonna hold the camera for you.
That's your moment. Like the post game speech with the winning quarterback. Nah, man, it wasn't me. It was my O line right there. Talk to them. I'm gonna go celebrate. I like that. So I gotta ask you then, what is your favorite track from there that you want? You want the vinyl so badly.
It's a toss up between the first two. I love The Glow and I love The Last Dragon. The Last Dragon is still on one of my like motivation playlists. And The Glow, you know, you got The Glow.
Well, we got that on deck, though. Yes. Let's do that. There we go.
It's. Hold on. Chat's about to understand what our obsession is, real quick.
Oh, my God. It just started already. It's so good, man.
Real.
Okay, vibe, man. We stand up a level. Your mind, body, and soul must be one. The best part is, too, when you're associating music, in this case with the movie, as much as I love the theme, I can't help but relate it to the scene where the whole point of the music was homegirls trying to smash Leroy.
You he's like, me some move?
Oh. He's just geeking out about the movie. He's like, oh, this the Fury. What? Meanwhile, she's got her arm around him like, yeah, you like this Fury, don't you? Where you going? Come back.
Bro, I got a train, bro. Like, let me get some of this real quick. Hold on.
She's like, train me instead. And he's over there shadow boxing. Boop, 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 boah. It's funny because that's where he gets the idea, too, of how to sneak into the fortune cookie place, I think it is. And then as he's leaving, that's when she's like, thanks a lot, Bruce. So long story short, I don't want to give you all information about how to run your love's lives, but if you have an SO or someone of interest, you got a playlist you're building for a special night, do not add this song because it is not going to work.
But at least don't put the video with it.
Yeah, don't put a pistol.
Don't give him something to shadow box along to.
I love that.
Don't be in there like a freaking a Just Dance stream or something.
That's a good choice. And I know how you feel when you say the hard part is trying to decide between that and Last Dragon. Because, I mean, Last Dragon, like, that's the moment. Everything yes. takes place. I can teach you no more. Dun, 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 dun. Like, that just hits.
Mm-hmm. Especially the moments when he's drowning him and he's just like, who's the master? And you see he's sitting there struggling. He's struggling. And then that one time he just come up calm as hell.
Bro said, I am. The smile on his face. When he knew. Dynamite.
Show enough should have known at that moment too. I'm like, yo, nah, just did he snap or something? Wait, what? We have been in all that anguish. What's
Bro
going
should have been shouting for his homies because it was a rap. For me personally, a vinyl that I don't have yet, and I do want, is right here, actually. I'll put it on the screen for y'all to see. Mm-hmm. The reason I have it on stream is because I've been thinking about it. Like, it's $22. And if y'all don't recognize this, this is Returnal, a game I was playing recently. And the music for it sounds really good. Like, I enjoy the way it sounds for each level. And I was fortunate enough to progress in the level. So I can actually hear a lot of the music that was taking place. But the big thing for me is the stage where you fight, I think it's Hyperion. Because Hyperion is just banging out an organ. We're talking about earlier, sometimes it's not so bad to do a difficult fight or a difficult journey if the OST is banging. Yeah. At first, when they first did the organ playing, I'm looking on the screen and it's bullet hell. There's projectiles everywhere. But for some reason, when that organ started really banging in there, I felt like I could see the Matrix. Like, I didn't have difficulty any longer. I just heard the music, and my brain was like, I got this, fam. Go ahead and turn off everything else. I'm like, all right, thank
when
you.
When that click and your focus changes, it's a different beast. Like, it's just, that's it.
You know, it's a great
none film. Of that extra stuff, it just makes sense. Man. Like, when you're dodging through a bullet hell, it just makes sense all of a sudden when you got that focus, when you got that glow.
It's what it is. And the funny thing is, like, with bullet games like that, there's not really set patterns. Like, there's different sets of projectile patterns they put out. There's not an overall phase one, they're going to do this twice, and then do this once. You just start seeing it. there's the gap. There's the gap. And that's like any game too. I'm sure when you're doing like RE Nemesis fights and you're like, I'm in a corner. Like, I've actually seen you a couple times where you're in a corner on a randomizer with spiders and Nemesis, and I'm like, oh my God, bro's dead. And out of nowhere, you're like, no.
Just a spot right here.
No. And then you just duck through and everyone just goes, ah, we all missed? How?
That's that's how it is. But once you find it, when you get that level of focus and with randomizers, I've done them enough to know to not panic in those situations, because I know the devs test the rooms out and they wouldn't put the room together if there was no way to get through it. I mean, sometimes it's hard because you might go in that room half dead, so you might not stand a chance, but there's always a way to get through it. And that's what I look at it like. I'm like, I'm getting my ass beat, but I know I can get around him somehow. So, all right, does this work? Nope. Let me turn a little bit to the left. Nope. All right. Nope. All right. What if I dash now? Okay. All right. That works.
I'm going to see if I can pull it up to listen to. I've been using another service instead of YouTube because it might pull your audio from both sources. So we're going to see. So let's try this. This organ, I'm telling you, is just... Why does it make me want to cry? I was in this battle fighting for my life and I didn't care. And then later on, bro just starts going ham on the organ. And the worst part is like me as the player, the entire time they are showing me their back. Like, I am not an apex predator. I'm not a predator. Like, they have their back turned to you and they're just doing this on the keys. Bro's just playing. I'm out there like, I'm like, I feel like I'm homeboy in, what was it? Was it Predator? Carl Weathers? My machine gun? I'm just like, I'm like a Batista entrance. Like, bro's back is getting lit up and he's just
sitting there just, you know, just jamming.
I'm like, am I a joke to you? Bro's got like four different segments of health, but it got me like hyped up just hearing this. It made me want to play harder.
Yeah.
Fight harder. It's just so good. Mm-hmm. It comes down to.
That's how I felt about Risk of Rain 2. There's a final boss in a game called Mithrix. When his music hits, like, the name of the song is actually really funny. It's called You're Gonna Need a Bigger Ukulele, which is ukulele is like a weapon that, you know, transfers electricity out in an attack, and the guitar from it is just like some heavy metal. And then when it the crooning of the guitar begins, it's just like, oh man, at that point he's probably already hit you at least once or twice, and you realize that you're not in a normal fight. So it's like when that guitar hits, it's just like, oh man, no, he's really not here to play. But at the same time, when it's hitting, you're just like, oh yeah, no, this is a good ass track. And then you're just like focusing on the track and watching what's happening in front of you, and you're just like, all right, I know he usually swings after this dash. He might do like a two dash and then the big hammer swing. Okay, I can do this.
I think there's a real moment of clarity when you notice patterns like that. The first time you do a fight, if you're able to adapt quickly, is when you've been kind of chilling, like, games are dangerous, don't get hit five times, we got this. But a certain fight like that, where the music's popping off, and you're dodging, let's say for 15 seconds, and you go, oh, it's not that bad. I think I got this. You see one rep spot, and the boss hits you one time, and your health drops to a fourth, and you go, oh. And it's not even one of those attacks where you think it's going to hit hard. Like when some mobs pull like a big gun out and it goes, woo, or a mob in the Soulsborne game gets their weapon and goes, ah. Like you dodge that and go, of course. It's the ones where they're like this. A four, three fourths, and you're like, oh!
Sometimes those caught you by so much surprise, you make the same noise like you the one that got hurt. Where'd my health go? What's going on here?
I'm locked in now. Give me a minute. All right, cool. All right, cool. We got that.
Not even I'm locked in. I'm locked out at this point. Like, I was in the zone and you just took me right out of it.
That's why I'm like,
do you watch Jeff Teague's podcast?
Yeah.
When he's talking about the story between him and Isaiah Thomas, and Isaiah Thomas got him off his game. And that's exactly what I feel like whenever I get hit by a boss, like, it just disrupts the rhythm. Like, now I can't hear the music.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's just like, oh yeah, we are fighting. Yeah, that's right.
You start hearing that Pokemon heal your Pokemon music in your head, that little boo-doo, 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 and you're like, it won't stop. I hear it for 30 seconds because I'm still bleeding for 30 seconds.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Even after it stops, I'm just like, I don't even want to go back to that. Like, because I know what he's hitting with. I don't think I got enough revives for this fight.
It's a wrap.
Let me stay over here.
What's keeping you safe these days then? What vine are you currently listening to? What's in your rotation?
So outside of the Risk of Rain ones, because when they release Risk of Rain Returns, like, I've been back on that. I've been listening to a lot of The Weeknd because I've been in my feelings.
Oh boy. Is that bad? Is that
bad? That bad, man. I've been listening to a whole lot of Kissland lately.
Bro, I'm telling you right now, I know you're not in a great state because look at that cover. Look at this. Like, yeah. Yeah.
It is. Every hour has been, I should call her hours.
Damn.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
But that's neither here nor there. That's neither here nor there. That's not what we're here for, right?
I didn't know if you wanted a discussion or not, but.
It is an absolutely gorgeous
vinyl. Oh my God.
Like, it is an absolutely gorgeous vinyl. All the discs are this color. And
so beautiful.
I love watching colored discs spin, and this is one of my favorites, to just sit there with a chair just pulled up and a glass of wine, just looking at it.
I'm sure Abel was doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
What are you listening to off there? What's the one that's got your attention?
Wanderlust right now.
Bro, all right. We need a conversation about how you answered that with the deep sigh attached to it. Like, you didn't say, oh man, it's Wanderlust. You said, it's Wanderlust.
You know, I'd rather not talk about it.
You do you. I bet. So I haven't heard this yet, I think, but I'm going to go ahead and queue it up so we can get a listen to it and see. Just if you want to plug your ears, unless you're going to be okay.
No, I can't hear the music anyway. I didn't want to make a big deal about it because I knew this was coming eventually.
Oh, bro, this opens up with the guitar. Nah, it's a rap. Never mind. This is an 80s style opening. This is where, like, the person is by the beach, sitting on their car hood, sunset, looking down at the hood, sad, looking at the reflection, and the reflection keeps, like, showing her or him. One of those cheesy 80s effects where the hood is so shiny, it just starts showing flashbacks in the hood.
I feel like you're rubbing it in at this point.
I'm not wrong.
You're not.
Oh my God. Yeah, this is definitely one of those scenes. Or the scene where they're driving down the highway and their Chevy Camaro, but after they're gone. It's always like a revenge thing too. Revenge race, revenge fight, revenge something. I told you, you're only one for me, right? I bet you say that to all the girls you meet. Nah, just you. Flashback cutaway. Damn.
Yeah, it's been between this. It's basically, I think, been the entire, like, B side. It's been between this and Tears in the Rain.
Oh, bro, this is a 5-minute long song, too. This is, oof.
You know how it goes sometimes, man.
It's got to feel like forever. Thank you for sharing that with us. That means a lot.
It either feels like 5 seconds or 5 hours, but that's neither here nor there.
Speaking truths. I feel that, honestly. I get that. Wish I didn't get that. But don't worry, we ride together.
Yeah, we all get it, unfortunately, right? Y'all get it, right, chat? Press one if you get it.
Press one if you get that, chat.
You don't have to say anything beyond that. Just press one.
You're in your 80s breakup mode right now. Press one. Respect that. I mean, honestly, for me personally, I've been listening to the Death's Door soundtrack, which is why I had it playing up in the opening. It was one of those games that, like, I don't have time to go back to right now. I'd like to go through it again, I think, if I could. Just because, like, from Jump Street, I felt like it was incredibly well done. It made me feel good when I was playing it. And sometimes, like, the thing is, Death's Door is a really good game. And I feel like I would have beaten it no matter what. But sometimes you get game fatigue because there's so much to do in a game. And every now and then I play a game where the music is so good, it's what gets me progressively through the game. To where it picks up again. Like, I get to a chapter 5 and I'm like, oh, bro, I got 10 more chapters of this. And then I know eventually once I reach chapter 11, I'm good again. But the music will get me through chapters 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 unexpectedly. And I just become so thankful for it.
Mm-hmm. That's, you know what? I hate to keep bringing up Risk of Rain, but that's exactly where it was with Risk of Rain 2 for me for a good minute. I guess I can DM you the track, but there was one particular song within a game. We were just like, yo, this, we kind of played to get to this level and then we would like chill out. And then half the time when we were taking the game seriously again, when the track really kicks in at about like, I want to say 3.5 minutes, we're just like, yo, we've probably been here too long.
Listen, when you start using music as a time crutch for a battle, that's when you know it's getting real.
Exactly that. It's like at 3:20 when the guitar comes in. And once you hear that guitar, I'm just like, I think I've been here for too long.
This is the track I've been listening to on Death's Door. Mm-hmm. Which y'all listening right now. It's actually from, it's Disc 1, Side A. You might have heard it during the opening. But it's called Lost Cemetery. And it's one of the earlier songs you hear in the game, too. Which is very rewarding. Because Lost Cemetery is one of the first areas you encounter. And to me, it musically set the tone for the rest of the game. Where the title opening screen, Death's Door, sounded really good. I enjoyed hearing it. I thought, okay, this might be a good game. There's a couple of boss fights that happens too. And this place, in the very first area you go in. And I feel like, especially in roguelites, because we'll be visiting the same area over and over again, that first stage has to hit so well because I'm going to get tired of hearing that theme. And even though this is more of a Zelda roguelike, like Tunic, Essential. Well, I guess it's not really a roguelike. We get the idea. But the opening area just sounds so good. I didn't mind how much time I spent there, but also how many times I had to go back there.
Mm-hmm. You're right, though. The opening soundtrack 100% sets that tone and that vibe for that game. Which is why Streets of Rage 2 was one of my favorite games of all time, because that opening song when that kicks in, I'm like, oh yeah, that's my jam right there.
The rain formerly known as Purple is what the one John was talking about from Risk of Rain 2.
So I don't know if you're playing it right now, but it's like the guitar kicks in at
20. I'm playing it. I will tell you right away, I got immediate flashbacks to the 1990s, late 80s, Teenage Mutant Turtles cartoon. The opening bass line of this song, the first 20 seconds, sounds like the transition music they would do going between the scenes of like the sewers to the streets that or seeing Baxter Stockman work on something. This opening bass line is beautiful.
It actually took its inspiration, if y'all can't tell from the title, from Purple Rain.
I think Prince is always the way to go for influence. We get the 3-minute mark. Ooh.
3-minute mark.
Okay, Synthwave, I hear you. See, the thing is, I don't even bump with Risk and Rain like you do. It's not an intentional thing. It's just at first it wasn't my game, but when I played it after you, I did play it solo a few times after. I was like, okay, I get the game now. It's a hard game for me to watch and go, oh, I'd want to play this, because when I watched play it, it was just numbers. It's like Vampire Survivors. There's so much chaos and numbers. I'm like, this looks like, how could this be fun? What's happening? And then as you play it, you go, oh, cool.
Once you play it, it's very, very hard to explain when you don't when the person you're explaining it to has never had their controller in their hand, really.
Yes.
It's like, I can tell you what this means and what that means, and you're just like, oh, that's okay, that's cool, but you don't get it until you've, like, done it. And it, that sounds, I guess, weird, but that's exactly how this genre of game kind of works. And then when you get it, and you're just like, oh, I understand what those constant red ticking numbers mean now, and what this, with that, when that big red highlighted number means now, and then when everything else is popping up like that, like it makes sense now, and I understand what these items are actually supposed to do. And then, you know, trying to, you know, do that math and then get that wonderful build every time is just like, it's a different feeling when you get it going.
Times I played with you, there were times when a lot of us, we made some good times together, went off our pretty head, but if we all died, it'd be you. And you go, oh, wait, I got this. All right, we should be good. I'm like, bro, we should be good? I'm seeing things floating in the sky, things in the ground. I see 2 minutes left. The dead zone area is shrinking. And I'm like, oh, he's right. We are good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I've got enough hours in that game to realize, like, I can look at what somebody has, and I'm just like, at this point, I may have made a mistake, but I threw, right? I'm like, I threw when I did that. I'm like, I don't think that this part you're going to throw when you do this, because you're like not looking to do it. So, or you're just more conscious about it. So I'm like, oh yeah, no, with what you got and what you're going against, like, you know, as long as you know, keep strafing to the left, you're good.
You get it. Mm-hmm. Also, yes, like in Venom, when the guitar hits is when the parent teacher conference happens.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. I've seen those movies too.
There's a specific enemy in the game called parents. And whenever they show up in droves, we call them the parent-teacher conference.
Oh, he meant from the game. I thought he was referencing like an 80s or 90s film.
No. In the game. And it's usually around when that guitar starts hitting is when they show up in droves. You might see like one or two before that, but that's when they let the whole meeting out, when that guitar kicks in.
Beautiful. Guess I gotta go back and play it now. Are these available on podcast services? Not yet. I'm trying to make sure I get consistent with the show before I start promising podcasts, but once we're there, this will be podcasts. Because like every other dude in America, I'm like, you know what? I should start a podcast. That's the joke, right? Everybody's like, you know what? I think everybody wants to hear what I have to say about the San Francisco 49ers on a weekly basis.
For sure. Yeah, that is. That is. Yeah.
Yeah. I think what I want to do with you is I want to do a part two to this, because the shows, I'm trying to keep them under an hour and a half now, closer to an hour. We've done that, but I feel like there's more I want to discuss with you. So I want to get you back one here on Wax and Wax for a part two in the future, in the next month. Think we can do that?
I'm absolutely down to do that. And I think we discussed this earlier. I didn't get a chance to show this yet.
Okay.
But I can switch this over for the stream right now.
Oh, yeah. Show me your setup.
I have like an entire setup, and there's like an audio cable that runs from the back of that into my streaming setup. So at any point I could play a vinyl. I could grab a vinyl right now and it would come through my setup and the stream would hear it. Your stream would hear it.
They would.
Yes.
Cap.
Prove it?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. Let me pick a record.
Hear that chat? That was easy bait. That's why we do that. It's easy bait oven. I've been told I need to stop men with podcasts. So both of you hand over your microphones. That's the difference. This is a vidcast. All right, Metal Gear. I see that. Shout outs to the Metal Gear soundtrack. I'm quite familiar with that one. I would like to hear it. Be more curious to see which track he picks. We play some bets, y'all. What do you think? What Metal Gear song are we going to hear? My guess is going to be the Danger Chase theme. That doom, 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 boom, 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 boom. Hey! It does work!
You can hear it, right?
Yeah, I called Cap and I was wrong.
I went through a lot of work to get this set up the way it is.
I was going to say.
But at any point, I could play a vinyl record right through there.
I'm just happy. Actually, technically, this is a mixture of the Danger theme and the opening theme, the title screen theme. Well, not really, I guess, the title screen, but the FMV that leads to the title screen.
Yes, that's exactly what this is. This is the
You know a soundtrack is good when I know I have 3 games I'm playing, 8 games I'm on hold and going back to periodically over a month, and 15 games I gotta play next, and hearing this, I'm like, you know what I should do?
No, real talk. The Metal Gear Solid soundtrack has that.
You know exactly what I should do. I should play Metal Gear Solid from to completion. It's a good ass idea, Adrian. Are we jamming in chat?
I know that is. I'm like, should we cut it? Should we let them keep jamming?
Nah, we're gonna wrap it up because y'all gonna get me mixed up. I'm gonna stay here and just
let me go cut it off.
We gotta protect chat from themselves. Protect me. Help me. Cause they out here jamming and everything too. They jamming. They bubble rolling everywhere. Like
I see.
Everyone got it unlocked. Well, thank you for sharing that, man. I'm glad I was wrong.
You know, I'm glad that I just recently got the Crable replaced, too. Like, if we had done this last week, I would not have been able to do that.
Yeah, that's true. We had some put-off designs, so.
Yeah.
We're going to take this moment, even though we're going to have you back for a part 2. Go ahead and tell people where they can find you, what it is you do, where they can do it on socials and or on Twitch and all that good stuff.
All right, my name is JroctheGod. That's JROCTHEGOD. I'm going to put a smiley face in chat so you can see exactly what it looks like. You can find me everywhere by that name. Find me at Twitter, formerly Twitter. Soon to be Instagram because, you know, all the other social media sites are dying. But mostly Twitch and YouTube is where you can find me at right now. Getting a YouTube channel up and running. You'll see a lot of like roguelikes because that's my obsession at the moment. But a lot of no-handed content is returning. As you can, I've been playing Risk of Rain Returns no-handed lately. But that's where you guys can find me at. And you can probably find me in about an hour or so playing some Lethal Company with some friends over on my channel. But yeah, that's where y'all can find me at.
All right. Love and respect, man. Thank you for coming on the show. We'll have you
Thanks
back for a part 2. Thank you for the raid earlier, all the resubs, people dropping in. This will be available on Twitch VOD as well as YouTube VOD. And let's make this more consistent. For sure. Not only with John, but just like other people in the future. More importantly, thank all of you for watching Wax and Wax. It means the world to me. John, thank you for being a humble guest. Appreciate you, man.
Appreciate you having me, man. I'm glad that we got this done. And I can't wait to have a chance to do it again. And if we do it again, can we bring on a third guest for another episode?
Yeah.
I think we should, if I run it back, I think I would love to have to run it back with Cup.
Yeah. Yep. Bet. Okay, bet. Yeah, it'll be a reunion show. Mm-hmm. All right, bet. Let's do that. Good idea.
Yes.
I'll see you then.
All right, man. I'm out of here. Peace, y'all.
All right, y'all. Thank you so much for watching the show. Thank you. Good night.